Right, so we've seen how the plight of migrants all over the world, we've had a look at that, and we're going to be talking now with Ms. Rana Rahim, who is the country director for the International Center for Migration Policy. Thank you, ma'am, so much for being with us on our program today. This is a very important topic right now in the world that we see. We are seeing migrants in all different countries due to all different reasons. We're seeing a migrant crisis in the United States. Now we're seeing it in other parts of the world as well. So as your role as a country director for this organization, what do you think right now is the most important thing, step that needs to be taken to keep in perspective the issue of migrants and how they need to be treated and the hardships that they face?
Migration is definitely not a new phenomena. This is something that has been happening for a very long time. Migrants have built nations, migrants yes. have contributed to their countries of origin as well as to their countries of destination for hundreds of years and continue to do so. It just so happens that today in this highly sort of securitized world where the emphasis is on strict border controls, that you know we see a very different perspective or a greater awareness and social political awareness of migration. And in this context, I think it's even more important that we focus on the contributions of migrants yeah. and we ensure that their rights are protected. Mm-hmm. So ICMPD was created to make migration safe and orderly okay. and regular. Mm-hmm. And this ICMPD does through migration dialogues, through capacity building, through research, through policy advice and policy development.
Okay.
And one of the things that we do, particularly in Pakistan, through our migrant resource centers, is to raise awareness. I think the most important thing today is for migrants to know their rights, to be able to make informed decisions. They need to be aware of, where they're going, what their rights are, what their responsibilities are, and also to be fully, aware so that they can better protect themselves.
Mm. And be aware of what they're going to face. We also now have with us online Mr. Tammy Dulur, who's an international consultant, and he's a journalist, as well as a filmmaker, and he's the director of the Meta Story Institute and senior lecturer of applied science in the Netherlands. Thank you so much for joining us, sir.
Hello.
I'd like to ask you to begin that we're talking about migrants. Today is International Day for Migrants, and it's a very important topic because we see migrants all over the world. And at times we also see crises like you've seen in the United States recently. Migrants are coming to a different country for a purpose. It's usually due to religious persecution or mistreatment or some sort of economic or other life hardship. And then they're often persecuted and face hardships where they end up. So your comments on this, sir.
Yes, well, thank you for inviting me. Of course, migrants have been with us all through history. And we found and we still see that migrants move because of many reasons. And you just mentioned some of them. Many are good reasons, for economic reasons, but also for safety reasons. They are fleeing persecution, like you say, and sometimes a disaster or war, as we've seen in Syria, for instance, where many of the refugees have fled, but also, of course, in your own country, where people have come for many, many decades now from Afghanistan and from other regions. And of course, Pakistan has been very generous in having all these migrants. We call them refugees, so they are there for a special reason. But of course, we know that from Pakistan and from other nations, people are going somewhere else to work often and to build new futures.
Right. So, sir, how can developed countries now help the situation of underdeveloped countries where you have influxes of migrants from so that their situation is improved so that, you know, it's not an easy thing for a person to leave their homeland and go to an entirely new place where they're an outsider and have to settle their family and they have to face a lot of hardship and a lot of times you've seen discrimination as well.
Yeah, that is true. And for instance, in Europe, which I know best, we have had an influx of migrants and refugees recently, and actually, as the European countries are getting older and grayer, the generations. We see the population of so-called source nations of migrants have very young populations. So it is also a matter of supply and demand of people and workforce, an exchange between, for instance, Europe and Asian countries. And of course, there needs to come a change in thinking about migrants. We've seen so much discussion recently and even discrimination and racism surrounding the issues of migrants, even in Europe, but also I understand in your nation. And this is it's not a productive and a long-term perspective at all. We need to change our ways and look at migrants in a much more positive way, where both supply and demand of people and force, and also in that way of futures, can be exchanged between the different nations.
Please stay with us. I'd like to now add Ma'am Rana, who's with us in the studio, that like you were saying earlier, that migrants often contribute a lot to the country's economy and as far as, you know, the fields of science, technology, etc. You see them in the West, they're doing very well in the medical fields and all of that. So they actually do contribute a lot to the host countries where they arrive. So that needs to be acknowledged as well, right?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And with the focus on, you know, irregular migration, we lose that. Mm-hmm. You know, we forget the contributions that migrants make.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the things to counter that is to ensure that migrants make informed choices and there is more regular migration. Mm-hmm. Because we've also seen the tragic consequences of irregular migration. Mm-hmm. You know, the depths that migrants will go to just to move to a different country for various reasons, whether it's because of, you know, conflict at home, whether it's, like you said, climate induced, or for whatever reason, mm-hmm. Primarily for economic reasons. But they have to be able to make informed choices, mm-hmm. And also make sure that when they're leaving the country, that they do so with legal protection.
Right. Mr. Delorna, I'd like to ask you, ma'am just mentioned climate reasons. Now, we are seeing a huge climate change, you know, greenhouse effect induced crisis all over the world. We know that there's going to be climate induced migrations going on in the future. How do we plan and how should we plan to accommodate this? Because many regions of the world are going to become uninhabitable.
Yes, well, we don't know exactly how all this climate change will impact all of our societies globally. We do know that most of the refugees and migrants that come from regions where the climate effects are very important, that they stay actually in the region. So, for instance, in Africa, we see that most of the people moving because of climate reasons, they stay within Africa. And I don't know exactly how this is with Asia, but I know on Europe, the consequences of the climate change has happened really hit the migration debate. We see people come to Europe, especially now from the war zones and coming from Africa for many economic reasons that are there. And of course, in there is people that are not migrants only, but they are refugees seeking asylum in these states. And I think Europe has to think through how we look at the asylum seekers for climate, with climate reasons to flee. So this could be drought, of course, and poverty caused by climate change and the other effects that are there. But this discussion will have to take off to a new level, really, in Europe. That's what we see.
Right, absolutely. So, Ms. Rana, now I'm going to ask you this, that you're here in Pakistan and your work is to sort of prepare migrants for what they're about to experience. Now, we've seen that many migrants end up in foreign countries where they've sort of been told lies or duped into going for a certain job or for labor, and they end up in a completely different situation. We've seen cases of human trafficking, forced marriages, etc. So how are we preventing things like that from occurring?
Well, you know, the government here is also developing a number of sort of, you know, policy frameworks and structures, mm-hmm. to deal with some of these issues. Mm-hmm. They're also looking at, you know, the policies that they had in the past and updating them, you know, to meet these kind of changes that are happening. And ICMPD has been assisting the government, particularly the Ministry of Overseas Pakistanis, to develop a comprehensive immigration policy that will not only promote migration from Pakistan, which is one of the priority areas for the government of Pakistan, given, you know, the huge population, particularly the huge youth population. So, you know, employment overseas is something that the government of Pakistan uses as a tool to deal with unemployment. Mm-hmm. So these policies, as well as, you know, raising awareness amongst the migrants themselves, and also assisting the institutions that are looking into the law enforcement agencies that are actually countering or migrant smuggling and human trafficking, we're also assisting them. Even the government itself is taking steps to strengthen these institutions. So these are some of the ways in which the government is being quite proactive in dealing with this situation.
Right, okay, at this point also now, Mr. Dhullar, I'm gonna direct a question to you that you mentioned earlier that Pakistan is already hosting 3 million Afghan refugees over here, or migrants. Many of them have settled here as well. First of all, I just wanna clarify what the difference between a refugee and a migrant exactly is. And secondly, I'd like to ask you, as far as the situation you're seeing in our neighboring country, India, where you're seeing now a lot of people there's uprisings due to the perception of, you know, the persecution of Muslims over there and other religious minorities. So Prime Minister Imran Khan has said in Geneva that he feels that there could be a potential refugee crisis in Pakistan due to that, or in Bangladesh. So your comments on this, sir.
Yes, of course, this is a very special situation for Pakistan. Now, let me make clear that there is a big difference between migrants and refugees. Migrant is a much broader category of people that are moving from a place to another place. And this can even be within Pakistan. Then you can be called a migrant if you're leaving your location. But most of the times, we understand that as a person going across a border to settle somewhere else in a new environment. A refugee is somebody that is seeking asylum by obtaining a legal status to stay in a country because he or she is persecuted for whatever reason in their home countries. And so through the asylum procedure, will seek a permanent residence or temporary residence, like many of the Syrians have done and many of the people from other countries have done. And I understand also that now there is tension with the new law in India, and Prime Minister Khan expressing his worries that many people will start fleeing and coming as refugees maybe to Pakistan from India and from the special regions that you mentioned. So this is what we see in many regions, that people become actually almost a bargain between different states and are forced into a political game being played with. And this is totally something that we should try to avoid by any means. And I really hope that the international diplomacy and wisdom of the national leaders of the different states involved will do their ultimate best to not let people become the play game and the playground and their lives being at risk because of international conflicts. They should be solved by another way. And we should make regular migration the standard norm between nations. And that is the way to go forward, because we cannot stop migration in general, and we should not, because there is good reasons, as we explained, for people to wanting to do that.
Right, absolutely. Thank you so much, Mr. Tammy Dhullar, for joining us from the Netherlands. And now, ma'am, Ms. Rana Rahim, now I'm going to ask you a final question, that seeing the situation in our neighboring country, that there could be a migrant issue starting from there, because not necessarily you can say, you know, that we're going to have an influx of refugees. Maybe that will happen too. But there are already people in Indian-occupied Kashmir who, due to the lockdown and curfew and all that they're facing, yes, they're very determined to fight it out, but a lot of them have applied for visas to Pakistan. They want to move, etc. So how should Pakistan approach this? Now, how can you be better prepared for it?
Well, this is something that is difficult for me to say. It's more, you know, it's more of a political decision by the government of Pakistan on how they respond to this. You know, I'm a proponent of open borders, even though, you know, I know that in this day and age, that's not a possibility, perhaps in the future at some point. So I would certainly open the doors to, you know, within limits, to those who want to come to Pakistan and welcome them, as we have in the past done with our neighbors in Afghanistan.
Absolutely. So welcome them with open arms, which is what Pakistan has always done, especially for our Kashmiri brothers and sisters. Thank you so much, Ms. Rana Rahim, for joining us today on our program and for your valuable insights.